Let's go.
Are you ready?
I'm gonna put your chair down just a little. Yeah, that's better. All
right. Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome on this beautiful, beautiful day today. The day is always beautiful, Mike.
Absolutely.
And today we have a very, very special guest. We have Rhonelle Bruder from the R.I.S.E. Initiative.
Yes.
And Mike, I always like to throw this back at you, and I will. What is the R.I.S.E. Initiative?
R.I.S.E. Initiative is an effort that Rhonelle started many years ago, and it's to bring awareness to human trafficking, specifically sex trafficking. What makes this person, you know, Rhonelle is amazing. What makes this whole story so powerful is that she's lived through these experiences herself as a young girl, being homeless. This is an episode that, look, you know, don't grab your popcorn.
Right.
Okay. I mean, it's pretty amazing. I mean, it wasn't as heavy as I thought it could be. It would have been. But we did touch on so many things that you need to hear. It's definitely not a problem that is out there and beyond and just in movies like Taken.
Yes. Okay. That's right.
Which I did work with the director of Taken. Yeah, just throw that in there. But again, that gives us a picture, but it's not the true picture. Rhonelle came in and gave us everything from like how to make sure that young daughters and nieces and sisters are safe.
Yes.
With social media.
Yes.
And some best practices like that. So this is something that applies to everybody. It's not just an isolated problem.
Right. Any parents out there that have kids, you want to listen to this episode. Any kids that listen to this episode, you want to listen to this episode.
Yeah, absolutely.
Absolutely. Next, I'm Standing in the Six.
Straight out of the T-Dot.
That's what it is.
Live from the Six Boroughs.
Don't go nowhere.
For sure. Welcome to Standing in the Six. With your hosts, Michael and Constantine.
You ready?
Yes.
You ready to dive in?
Yes.
Let's do it.
All right. Amazing.
I'm a little nervous.
Are you nervous? Oh, my goodness, Mike. Let me help you out, buddy. Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome on this beautiful, beautiful morning. I'm excited. I'm always excited, Rhonelle. Always excited.
Yes.
I think it's a good way to just start the day, just being excited. But today we have Rhonelle. And who is Rhonelle? Rhonelle is founder of the R.I.S.E. Initiative.
And Rhonelle Bruder?
Bruder, yes.
Bruder is a proper way to say it.
That's right.
We always clarify, make sure.
Yes, we always do. We always do. One thing about us is we don't fact check all the time. Well, I don't, and I always make mistakes, and that's me.
He's got a Mediterranean flair, so so names sometimes
yes, exactly.
They come out a little different.
That's right. I butcher them sometimes. I butcher them. But thank you very much for coming down.
Thank you.
How are you doing today? Everything well?
I'm good, yes.
Amazing. Amazing.
And sir, you were saying R.I.S.E. Initiative.
The R.I.S.E. Initiative. You know, the word R.I.S.E. I'll tell you this, just because I was watching Batman a couple of weeks ago. Did you watch Batman, the one where
like the cartoon?
No, not the cartoon, the movie where they all, it was with Batman versus Bane, and Batman had his back broken and he had to rise, basically.
Yeah.
Did you remember that? Yeah. And he had to jump out of those cliffs.
Yeah, and that's that crowd is shouting.
Shouting R.I.S.E.
For like 17 minutes.
Yes. Yes. That's a very powerful word.
Yeah.
Okay, the word R.I.S.E. Why don't you bring some context to what R.I.S.E. is?
Yeah, so first of all, the acronym is R.I.S.E., so it's Resilience, Inspiration, Strength, and Empowerment.
Okay.
And I launched that about a year ago with really the idea of wanting to support vulnerable youth.
Okay.
And so coming from my own lived experiences and seeing, you know, the challenges that young people, particularly young people that are at risk, have when they're trying to transition their lives.
Right.
And so I wanted R.I.S.E. to be a safe space where young people could talk, we could share stories, could share some of the things that worked for me, some of the tools and the strategies.
Yes.
And really focus on health, wellness, cultivating resilience. Yeah.
Right.
Life skills.
Right.
Amazing. Amazing.
Well, I know we were introduced to you by Ron Chinzer.
Yes.
Okay. And
yes,
I'm telling you, like,
the infamous.
The infamous, exactly. When Ron mentioned to us, you know, basically, you need to meet Rhonelle. I mean, I'll tell you right now, when we started going a little bit deep, it was kind of like jaw dropping. I mean, the information, the experiences that you went through, it was very, very, very jaw dropping. And I think the context of what we're going to get into, I think a lot of people may not really think it exists. To be honest, maybe they think it happened. We're talking about human trafficking.
Yeah.
But I'm thinking they think it may happen maybe like somewhere like in Asia, or it could happen somewhere in, you know, the deep jungles of Brazil or something. Yeah. I mean, I don't think people...
Which it probably does.
Right.
Yeah.
No, and the funny thing is, when Ron was here talking about gangs, there's a lot of naive people that don't think we have gangs. Oh, gangs must be the Bloods and the Crips. What's in Los Angeles? It doesn't exist in Toronto.
Yeah.
Why don't we just dive into a little bit of that? I mean, how this kind of like all started?
Yeah, well, I guess, well, first of all, I'll say what comes to human trafficking is, to your point, a lot of people have this idea, it's kind of like the movie Taken.
Yes.
So it's, you know, it's international, or if it's happening in Canada, it's girls, women, children coming from like Eastern Europe, coming from Asia, that are being forced into this country. When in reality, human trafficking in Canada, and particularly sex trafficking, is Canadian-born Canadian citizens. Wow. So 90% of victims are Canadian-born Canadian citizens.
Okay.
Holy smokes.
Yeah, that's pretty...
Yeah.
That's staggering. I wouldn't think that at all.
No.
Yeah.
No.
So that's kind of one of the misconceptions.
Okay.
And then I think...
So it's not their problem kind of thing. It's our problem.
No, it's 100% a local problem.
Yes. So with this stat in place, I mean, just because people's minds will be going right now as we're speaking.
Yeah.
What is human trafficking?
Yes. So it is the use of control, coercion, manipulation to force somebody into prostitution, sex acts, stripping, massage, things like that, for profit. And I'm specifically talking about sex trafficking.
Yes.
Under human trafficking, there is labor trafficking, forced marriage, and domestic servitude. But I focus mostly on sex trafficking.
Okay. Okay. Wow. I mean, to me, the fact that you just labeled all those descriptions, I would have not gone there. You know what I mean? To think that. I mean, the whole aspect of human trafficking with your experiences.
Yeah.
I mean, how did that kind of start? Like, how did it happen?
Yeah. So that's kind of like when most people ask us, how does that happen?
Yeah.
And for me, I was a vulnerable youth, so I had two sort of vulnerabilities. So I had physical vulnerability. I was experiencing homelessness. I'd left home, and I ended up in downtown Toronto.
Okay.
So kind of going in and out of youth shelters. So I was struggling to make my sort of basic needs met.
Okay.
Right. So I had those vulnerabilities, but I also had emotional, psychological vulnerabilities. And those are things that you can't necessarily see. Right.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And I would say that we all have vulnerabilities, like you and I, we all do as adults, but because we're adults, we're able to sort of have that protection up, whereas children don't. Right? Like, you're young, you don't know. And so predators are able to come in there and kind of spot those vulnerabilities in young people and then exploit them.
Now, how old were you when you left home?
I left home at 16.
So that's young.
Yeah. So I was a teenager.
Yeah.
And I was dealing with, well, I guess to kind of go back. So I was born in St. Vincent.
Okay.
And I want to say, I know you guys had a guy in here before that was born in St. Vincent and was adopted and grew up in London.
That's right.
And I was so surprised because, like, I've never met anyone else that had that story.
Really?
Because I was born in St. Vincent, I was adopted, and I grew up in London.
Whoa. That's crazy.
Okay. Yeah, and I was like, there's another one out there.
Yeah.
So growing up in London, when I did, you know, obviously things have changed, but there wasn't a lot of Black people, right? Mm-hmm. So there wasn't that inclusivity, you know, kind of thing that happens right now. And so I faced a lot of discrimination, a lot of bullying. And so really, I always felt isolated, you know, kind of felt like alone, like I didn't fit in. And so for me, my psychological vulnerabilities was that need to belong.
Okay.
You know, the need for a sense of belonging.
Right. Yeah. Absolutely.
Wow.
And having been, you were adopted, right? And that's how you came from St. Vincent.
Yeah.
Okay, so at 16, I guess you weren't looking for belonging. I guess you were looking to just get out.
Well, I think I was. Yeah. I think I was. Yeah, I think. I mean, I don't know if I would have articulated it that way, right?
Yeah.
But I think I was looking for that. I was trying to sort of escape what I felt were my problems, and, you know, try to find that sense of community, that sense of place where I could be, where I could feel like I really fit in.
I've heard it said before, it's like trying to find your tribe.
Yeah, like your people.
Everyone's just trying to find their people, whether it's like, okay, you love chess like I love chess, or whatever it is.
Yeah.
Okay, so you come to Toronto.
Yes.
And it probably looked a lot different. Not as many condos.
No, as many condos. Okay, no.
And it was called the Sky Dome.
Yes, at
the time.
Yeah.
And what was it like? What was your experience being on the street?
Well, for me, so first, you know, coming from a small town, going to Toronto was like, oh my God. It was, you know what I mean? So there was like that level of excitement first, and then coming, and I just stayed with friends. So I initially just started kind of like couch surfing with different friends. And then I guess when I kind of wore out my welcome, then I ended up on the streets. But I was fortunate. I was a young person. So there is a lot of services for young people that are homeless.
Right.
You know, there's Covenant House. There's all these places that you can stay.
So, mission.
Yeah. So I was really fortunate. So I was able to sort of go into there and have that protection.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. But still didn't have really stability.
Okay.
So even though I was able to, you know, at the time I was living in transitional housing, you're still not really stable. I didn't have that sense of security either.
Mm-hmm. Wow. So you're in the mix right now. Yes. And down, you're going through this, jumping around. Yeah. What now takes your path? By the way, why are you down here? How long is this window now before it gets into this like red zone? Like when is it?
Yeah, I was probably in Toronto kind of like for a couple months, you know, like couch surfing, doing all that kind of stuff for a couple months. Had found transitional housing.
Yeah.
And then just ended up meeting a girl.
Okay.
So another misconception. People right. always think that people get lured into trafficking by men.
Yes.
Right. But a lot of times women are used as recruiters.
Okay.
So
how old is this girl?
I would guess she was probably like 19, 20. She wasn't that old. She wasn't wow. that much older than me.
So when you're looking at her, you're like thinking, okay, I can relate to this girl almost.
Yes. And she was okay. almost for me like an older sister.
Okay.
You know, she was pretty. She was cool.
Yeah.
She had all these nice things. And I just remember going to her place and she lived in a condo. So if you're a teenager and you're living in a one-room place
yeah.
and you meet a girl who's like not that much older than you
yeah.
in a condo
right.
with like nice clothes and bags and her hair and her nails done, you're like, oh my God, like
yeah,
how do right. you have that life?
Yeah, so. And I guess that's exactly what the question had begged. Yeah. Did you ask her? Did she proposition something to you?
So we had conversations and she was like, you know, it's really easy. You know what I mean? I have these guys, they're helping me out. They're... You know, they helped me get the condo. So that was kind of the thing. They helped me get the condo. And I just kind of, you know, they helped me get work and stuff like that. I'm making this money. And then, yeah.
Wow. So you're having this conversation.
Yeah.
You're getting comfortable.
Yeah.
How long before you start, like, really getting curious now, thinking, you should check this out?
It wasn't that long. I mean, for me, sort of the idea of being able to go from, you know, like, living in poverty,
yes.
you know, struggling just yes. to make your basic needs, you're like in survival
for
mode
sure.
to be like having this glamorous life. I mean, didn't take that much to sell that to me, right?
Wow. Okay. So, I mean, so yeah. what happens right now?
Like, so then she introduced me to him.
Yes.
So that was a thing. So she was sort of like, you know, the person to kind of lure you in. And then she introduced me to him. And what I would say is that people think a lot of times traffickers or predators are going to be like this evil monster.
Right.
Yeah. This mean, cruel person. They're sadistic. You know,
yeah.
that was not the case at all.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Wow.
He was a nice guy. He was a nice guy.
Because again, every time, and I mean, the conditioning yeah. of media, I'm thinking of a, sorry to the Russians,
yeah.
but I'm thinking of a guy with a Russian accent. You
Igor.
Know, yeah, Igor. That basically,
yeah.
you know.
Boris.
Yeah, that's very, very scary
yeah.
and, you know, has no personality.
Yeah.
Like, and that's kind of what I'm thinking of right now.
Yeah. No. No, he was, you know, like a nice person.
Right.
And so that's the thing is you have to build that trust.
Yes.
Right. And so if someone was to meet you and right away, you know, physically abusing you, you know, hurting you.
Right.
I mean, as soon as you have a chance, you're going to run away.
So they're playing the game.
Yeah. You know what I mean? But if you build that trust and that relationship with somebody, and that really was, and for me, I would say he sort of represented almost kind of like a father figure.
Okay.
So that protection, that I care for you, I'm going to look out for you kind of thing.
Now, how old would this guy be? Like if you were to, if you have a 19-year-old person that
yeah.
you can relate to.
Yeah.
When you're seeing father figure at 16,
yeah.
you look at 25-year-olds as old guys. You
yeah.
know what I mean? Like, you know what I mean?
yeah, yeah.
You know what I mean? So like...
I would probably say he was maybe in his like late 20s, early 30s.
Okay,
I guess.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So yeah. Not that old as
yeah.
well.
Yeah, yeah.
And okay. what did he lay out? Did he... Was it an... And this is where, you know, we're yeah. hoping just to kind of get some of the details of how it happened. Is it something that you... did, you know, was our plan laid out and said, look, this is exactly
yeah.
how it works?
Yeah, this is what
or,
I can do for you. Here's the world.
It,
yeah.
Or was it incremental? Is yeah. it like step by step and over time you found yourself?
Yeah. So really what it was, okay, so, you know, I want to help you. I want to help you sort of better your life. So this is how it kind of works. You work dancing. You know, have you tried stripping? Have you heard of stripping before? And I think I'd seen like the movie Striptease. So I was like, okay.
Yeah. yeah.
And so, you know, do this. You work in the club for a couple months and then you'll be able to have enough money. You know what I mean? Like you'll have enough money for your day-to-day living expenses. All the rest of the money I'm saving for you.
Wow. That's how you positioned it.
I'm saving it for you because, you know, I'm a kid. Like I don't even have like a bank account.
Yes.
I don't know how you like put a down payment on a condo.
Right.
Wow.
Right. So, but I know. He's
yes.
like, I know how to do that stuff. So, you know, I'll take care of everything. I'll help everything. I'll save that money for you. Then once you get that down payment, then you're in a condo. It's that simple.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
Jeez.
And again, yeah. you know, you're young, you're naive.
Yeah.
And I think also too, when you're in kind of like that desperate situation, you want to believe.
Okay.
You know?
Yes. So you basically go through with it.
Yeah. So I was like, okay.
And how long did you do that for? This down payment stuff? Like,
So the whole time I was in situation was only for a few months.
Okay.
And so I guess I would say I was fortunate in that sense that we started working in the strip clubs, and right away, it didn't take long for me to sort of start to see what was going on.
Right.
So, you know, it's kind of like smoke and mirrors. Like in the beginning, everything looks glamorous and sexy and cool. And then after a while, you start to see, you know, girls getting beat up. Everyone's high all the time.
Right.
Customers you have to deal with. Guys constantly, you know, you're getting like assaulted. Like it's all of a sudden you're like, no, this is not sort of what I thought it was going to be.
Right.
So now you're in.
Yeah.
You know, and this is the thing. It's not as it seemed, but you're saying it from the perspective of being on the inside now.
Yeah.
So now that you're inside, does it seem like there's hope that you can get out? I mean, you now have a place of your own. Did you end up having a place of your own?
Yeah, so I had my like little, you know, transitional housing that I was living in. And I think that, and see, this is where it gets really like complicated, because there is a relationship that is created between the victim and the trafficker. So whether that's like a loving relationship, like boyfriend, girlfriend kind of relationship, or a sense of like family, a father figure relationship. And so it's hard to just leave that.
I guess there's a level of intimacy.
Yeah, you know what I mean? There's like a bond that's been developed. And so even though there's fear, there's intimidation, those things are happening, you know, the person's not, like abusers aren't constantly abusing.
Okay.
Yes.
Right? Like, you know, like it's like domestic violence. Like they'll be, you know, abusive, and then they'll come back and like flower you with roses, like shower you with roses and things. So it's like that back and forth. So even though they might be hurting you, at the same time, they're also really nice to you.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Yeah. And that's what makes it, I guess, convoluted. You don't really.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so I think that's hard.
Was there a moment that you saw it clear, or, you know, this, you know, your whole initiative of RISE to help vulnerable youth identify these things in their life and have the strength to get out?
Yes.
And identify the allies, the you know, the lifelines that they can have. I think that's one of the reasons, you know, we talk about this. There's a word kind of this year that we've heard is accessibility. And it's not that someone might have all the ability, but they don't have the access to the right, say, tech software or, you know, or basketball trainer, or like it can make all the difference.
Yeah.
So it's amazing what you're doing, that you're creating resources for people to access that have lived through what you lived. When you didn't have this, how did you get out? Because I think that's the most amazing thing about your story is not that what you said earlier, you went through.
Yeah.
Right.
You went through, which means that you got through it. You're on the other side right now.
Right.
What was it for you? Was it was there a moment that you saw, I guess, the beast in this person?
Yeah. So I think that although I was contemplating leaving, you know what I mean? Like, you know, it didn't take long for me to say, like, I didn't want to do this. But then I didn't kind of know what to do. And I also felt like I had this almost like an obligation to this person, because they helped me. And they were the only person helping me right now. Mm. You know what I mean? So it's almost like, if I don't have this person in my life, I have nothing.
Okay.
Right? But I think for me, sort of the, I guess, trigger would have been just, and there was, like, for me, there was never any violence. So he was never abusive to me. He never hit me or anything like that. But I witnessed him physically assaulting another woman. And that was the first time I've ever seen that. I'd ever seen, you know, a man beat on a woman, period. But let alone someone that I cared for.
Mm-hmm. And I think, you knew the woman.
Yeah, I knew her. Yeah, she was a young girl. And so I think for me, that was the trigger point where it was like, this is serious. Do you know what I mean? If he can do this to her, at some point, inevitably, he's going to do this to me.
Yes. Wow. Yeah. Okay. And then, so then what happened from there? So you have this moment, you see it clear. I want to kind of just, I think it's important to describe this gentleman or gentlemen like this that you know, that take part in this. Is this someone that would just be at Indigo reading a book? Okay, get in a Starbucks. Is it someone, you know what I mean?
Like, where would you meet these kind of people?
And just to get an idea, because media paints a very, paints and casts and puts up there very cliche.
Very cliche.
Yeah.
Okay.
Very cliche.
And we look at it and be like, and that makes it very easy for the common person to say, like, that's their problem.
Yeah.
I don't know those people. I don't associate with those people. But would it surprise Canadians, Torontonians that, like, oh, it actually could be this person, you know, without even knowing?
Well, I mean, before you say that, I mean, we were talking about this earlier. When you have guys like Jeffrey Epstein.
Yes, right? Epstein,
Billionaires. Mm. Influential people, right? What was his crime? You know, he was basically targeting...
Sex trafficking.
Yeah. You know what I mean? And, Mike, I mean, that's the scary thing. It could be anybody. It could be anybody.
Yeah.
Was that kind of like what your experience with this individual, when Mike was asking, was that when you're describing this guy?
No, I wouldn't I mean, he wasn't a billionaire. I would say he was more like of a street person.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? So he was someone who would have been like, you know, involved in like drug traffic, you know, other kinds of you know, street things.
Right. Yeah. Okay, so just one of, I see.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. But obviously very, he knew how to postulate to be very trustworthy and.
Oh, yeah. I think like all sort of, you know, traffickers, predators, I mean, they're sort of master manipulators.
Right.
And that's what they're able to do, right?
So. Right.
Yeah.
When you're in this, I'm going to call it a bubble.
Yeah.
Okay. Because you're in this and your world is not really being, penetrated by anything else. Is there anybody in the outside that is connected to you and saying, "Rhonelle, what are you doing? Like, you got to get out of this. This doesn't look right." Do you have any of those voices right now?
So no. So at the time I was estranged from my family.
Okay.
Right. Like I already had left home. So I was estranged from my family and, you know, it was then you're on, you know, with kind of like that street people and then sort of in that world. So everyone I knew was in that space. And that's, I think, another problem is it becomes so normalized to you.
Wow.
Because everyone, all the guys I knew were like selling drugs, you know, pimps, you know, all the girls I knew were, you know, doing something like this.
Right.
So to us in that world,
this is normal.
Yeah. And it almost seemed as if, and this sounds really silly to say now, but it almost seemed as if like we knew the secret. Like we knew something no one else knew. Like we knew we were hustlers.
Yes.
You know what I mean? You know what I mean? So it's kind of like we were the ones who had it.
Right.
The rest of the world were like squares going to doing a 9-to-5. But, you know, so there's also kind of that brainwashing, I think.
For sure. And that makes sense because I've known people over the years that, you know, will articulate things like that, what you're describing. Because to them, what they're doing on is the secret sauce. But when you're seeing it from a different set of eyes, you're like, well, what's going on here? Like, you got to reach out. So right now you have this moment and you're like, I need to get out.
Yeah.
Do you have this conversation with this guy right now and say, I'm out?
No. There's no, is there, yeah.
No, you wouldn't do that.
There's no pink slip that you see.
Exactly.
Say,
I'm out. Okay. Yeah.
No.
So it's literally, what do you do?
No, I was fortunate. I was able to get in touch with some of just like the street friends that I knew and was just kind of like, guys, like you guys have to come and just like help me. I got to get out of here. And so I was able to kind of like just go like leave. I literally just left and then just kind of stayed like underground and just like outside, stayed away from everybody. Just kind of like hid out for a couple months.
Is this guy trying to get a hold of you right now? Like, is he calling you down? Or paging.
Yeah,
you.
No. So, So, there was cell phones then.
Okay.
No, but no. So you know, this is the thing. So a lot of people ask that. They're like, "Were you afraid when you left?"
Yes.
And I wasn't, because this is probably the sad, honest truth about it. Is these guys don't even care enough about you.
Wow.
Because as soon as you're gone, there's 20 other girls. Wow. They're already lined up.
Wow.
So it's like, why spend that extra energy trying to chase down Rhonelle?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. I got other girls.
Wow.
There's no chase because there's a lineup.
Yeah, it doesn't, like, which honestly is almost like hurtful.
Yes.
When you're young, because you're kind of like, in a weird way, you kind of want them to chase after you.
Yes.
But they don't care.
So you got out.
Yeah.
Okay. And you moved on. And before we're going to go into that, that transition, do you know people that stayed or are still under bondage, basically, and in that environment, or something happened worse from being?
Yeah, well, I've just over the years, I've known tons of women who have been, you know, victims of trafficking, and a lot of times what I found is they might start off, you know, in a trafficking situation, they might leave that trafficker, but then they stay in the sex industry. Because what people understand is once you've already been in that industry, you don't necessarily have, you know, the skill sets to work in the professional world. Do you have an education? You know what I mean? Like, what can you do elsewhere? So a lot of women, particularly if they have kids, end up feel that they have to stay in the sex industry.
And I'm also pretty sure that things like self-worth, insecurity,
self-esteem,
all these are piling on top of each other, which are saying, how is the world going to even accept me?
Exactly.
There's no chance.
Exactly. That's what, there's a lot of shame and there's a lot of like guilt and stigma. And even now, like I talk to women who have been out of like the life for, 20 years, 10 years, and they still carry that shame and that stigma.
Wow. Yeah, the shame, what's interesting about shame, it's incredibly powerful.
It is.
And it throws a shade on you where you always feel that even if the sun comes out, you're not worthy of it.
Yes.
To step in it.
Yeah.
That's for them because they didn't do what I did.
Yeah.
Well,
how did you get past that shame?
Yeah.
I think for me, so after I got out and, you know, there wasn't, you know, kind of services like there is today. There's a lot of services for psoriasis today. I ended up having my daughters and I ended up becoming,
amazing.
A single mom. Mm-hmm. But, you know, even though that's not necessarily a great thing, but for me it was because it all of a sudden gave me a sense of purpose.
Okay.
Okay. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. So even though maybe I wouldn't have had the strength to do these things for myself,
right?
I now had a little baby girl that right. I had to protect, that I had to do things for. And so then it was, I think that really pushed and motivated me to go back to school.
Okay.
To yes. do these things to better her life.
Right.
Yeah.
Which you have your master's yeah. and you yeah. have an honorary bachelor's as well.
Yes.
Right. Which is amazing. So you did that while being a single mom.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. Amazing.
Yeah.
And this is truly, as you're talking, even though the acronyms of the RISE.
Yeah.
This is truly a RISE.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. yeah.
I mean, think about this. What you're, not only were you put in this experience, I mean, your experience prior to that was tough.
Yeah.
Okay. And you found a way to get out. And then on top of that, this is where it now truly starts to inspire me. What I yeah. hear what you're, is that you're trying to help others now.
Yeah.
See, it could be one thing just to get out and move on.
Yeah.
But you're now trying to be like, I want to point the message out right now. This is what you need to do to avoid that. Or this is what you need to do to aware of what could happen in the surrounding if you do this.
Yeah. Right?
That's amazing.
Yes.
That's amazing. And that honestly to me is immense. Oh. You're doing something major, and I'm really, really proud of what you're doing.
Thank
I mean, that's amazing.
Thank
can you speak to that? Why?
Yeah.
Why put your time
yeah.
into this? Because, I mean, just to escape that lifestyle yourself, to start, you know, your family and
yeah.
and to move forward, that's a lot in and of itself.
Yeah.
Why go back? Why talk looking and help people yeah. look back to your experiences? Most people, I mean, you know, they don't like, people are very private at the yeah. core.
Right.
They don't, you know, even this yeah. whole conversation, it takes great bravery and courage
100%.
To constantly say, like, I'll be the face of this
yeah.
in some regard. How come? Why do you do it?
Well, so what happened, I mean, I initially, you know, I went back to school. I did all these things. I was, like, working, raising my daughter, just, you know, living sort of a regular life. And I had no intention of ever sort of sharing my story and doing this work. But I started to do volunteer. So I started volunteering. I was volunteering with young people. And they'd be having these conversations, and they'd always say to me, like, Miss, you don't understand. You don't get it. Like, you don't know what we've been through. And I was like, no. Oh, I know, you wow. know?
Yeah.
And then when I started to share my story, they're like, what? Like, they yeah. would always be so surprised. They're like, you, this, that, I can't believe it. And I think for me, that was like, there's really power in sharing the story. Because not only for other people who are still in the midst of it or trying to figure out their way, it's like, wow, like, if she can do it, I can do it too. You know, sometimes you need to see someone else kind of go through that pathway to believe it's possible. And so that to me was like why I want to share the story. And also I felt that all the things that I had learned through the way, and I mean like even before I went to school, just, you know, different life skills, things I picked up that helped me, mm-hmm. I wanted to share with them to, you know, sort of help them in their journey.
Yeah, that's amazing. The power mm-hmm. of belief, just to see that yes. someone else could do it. There's a great story on that. Jesse Owens, the famous track runner.
Yeah.
So I forget, it was the 40s or 50s. They actually believed no one can run a mile under 5 minutes. It was doctors of that day said that your heart would burst before you could actually run under 5 minutes. Guess what happens? Jesse Owens does it. He accomplishes it. It changes the whole world. No one's ever done it before. Within a year, something like 20 to 30 other runners actually accomplish it. So the only thing that changed is that one person was able to do it.
Yes.
So all of a sudden, now in high school, there's thousands and thousands of every students in high schools that can run the mile. Yeah. Okay. So, and that's just the power of seeing someone else has got through.
Yeah.
Okay. That's amazing. So look, so you're hearing this, they're asking, that's what's, it's cool. They're asking the questions.
Yeah.
At some point, do you think, like, what happened? Were you, you know, where were you? How was it for you to decide, okay, instead of this just being every now and then when they ask, I'm actually going to go out and now speak.
Yeah, so kind of, I think that was sort of like, I guess, sort of the starting point. And then I was like, you know what, I want to create something. I want to do something, you know, sort of something of my own, I think, that has sort of my unique kind of stamp on it. And I just love RISE. Like, I'm like, you know, the RISE, like the phoenix rises from the ashes kind of, mm-hmm. you know, thing. So I just love that concept. And RISE, so again, like resilience, inspiration, strength, and empowerment. And I was like, this is really what I want to speak to young people. So yeah, let me create something. Let me launch this initiative. And yeah, and then I kind of just started doing that. And then people just start to connect with me. And, you know, one thing leads to another. And then, yeah, I guess you're here today.
Look, I mean, I'm a father of a daughter, Mike is a father of two daughters. Yeah. I have a son as well, but for the sake of this, daughters.
Yes. I have a son as well.
Sons are also important in this conversation.
Are.
Yes,
they are. Yes. So we're not they're not pushing them out, Mike.
Yeah.
No, but it's true. My daughter's starting high school.
Yeah.
Okay. And she's turning 14 and grade 9 into the 10, 11, 12 world of high school.
The wonderful world.
Obviously, the initial fears that she's stepping into a new environment.
Yeah.
But when I hear all this, I mean, as a father, mm-hmm. right, or parents,
yeah.
what can they do to, A, ensure their kids avoid, you know, these kind of things? So we're always telling our kids, listen, when you cross the road, look to the left, look to the right, mm-hmm. right? But we also want to give them situational awareness, skill sets. We want to equip them. Yeah. And for us in security.
You don't want to scare them.
But you don't want to scare them, exactly. Okay. Because they're probably thinking, come on, Dad, seriously? I mean, we want to put them on that right track.
Yeah.
What could parents do to, A, look out for these kind of things?
Yeah.
And two, just equip them with the right skill sets to,
Yeah. So I think, first of all, it's having those relationships with your children. So you're able to have these uncomfortable conversations.
Yes.
You know, whether you're, talking about sex, for one, right? I know a lot of parents are uncomfortable talking about sex with their children, but it's an important conversation to have.
Sure.
And then talking about human trafficking. But not just, human trafficking is this thing where someone's going to come and they're going to force you into prostitution. But the fact of, what does a healthy relationship look like? Hmm. What are boundaries? What is consent? Do you know what I mean? If someone asks you to do something you don't feel comfortable, what do you do? Because that's really what's, because they're not going to get kidnapped, but they are going to meet a guy that may say to them, I love you, I want to be with you, but hey, could you send me some nudes?
Yeah.
And this is happening right now to 14-year-olds. I mean, this is scary, but this is the truth, right?
Yes.
And then after the nudes, it's like, hey, my friend thinks you're hot. Do you think you could kind of do something with him? And and this is how it progresses.
Proposition.
Yeah. So I think building that sort of self-esteem, that self-worth in young people, and also educating them, boys and girls.
Yes.
What does a healthy relationship look like? Those kinds of things I think are important. And it's not just having the conversation once. It's a continual thing.
That's amazing. We can really talk on this for a while because what you just shared there, you have that insight. How does it look in this day and age?
Yeah.
Okay. So sending nudes. Okay?
Yeah.
With social media, this access that someone can connect you all over. People can create these phantom accounts and pretend that they're 17 when they're 47 and all these things. Can you give us an idea of some of the tactics that are used out there?
Yeah. So when it comes to social media, I mean, you have Instagram, you have Snapchat, there's MeetMe, there's Facebook, all those different platforms. But really what I would say is that children should know to keep their accounts private. So if somebody tries to reach out to you, or a friend, you don't know them, you don't accept them. Mm-hmm. That's one. But also not to divulge too much private information, because young people share everything. I mean, I share everything too, but young people share everything on social media.
Blows
and that's very dangerous, because if you're a predator, all you have to do is scroll someone's feed and you can know everything that's going on in their life.
It's true.
Right?
I mean, I was telling this to Mike the other day, I went away 2 weeks ago. And I know people just love sharing everything from down to the food they're having.
Yep.
But when people say things, and by the way, this is a security tip for everyone listening right now. When people say things like, hey, on our trip, and they actually tell you locations, I'm Pearson Airport going to Puerto Rico.
House empty.
House empty. You're telling the world.
14 days of fun.
14 days of fun. Can't wait.
I never thought of that.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
Yeah. People don't.
I mean, the minute you hear that, if I'm looking at it, I mean, Or someone else, it's like you said, not a non-private account. You're telling everyone that no one's at your house.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so to me,
if you have say four kids and you're so excited as a couple that you're going away because your kids are old enough to be on their own,
and you can't say that. Oh, I can't wait to leave the kids behind.
Yeah.
And then bam. So to me, 100%. I that's an incredible tip about making sure.
So keep it private.
Yeah,
so parents keep it private. And that's huge, because I mean.
Yeah.
Okay, so
yeah.
What were you going to say?
No,
you go.
I was saying, parents need to know, as you said, what the kids are doing. Do you know, there was actually an app. Maybe we can put this up. We can upload it on the Instagram account. That's non-private. But what there's all these apps that parents should be aware of that kids are using. Do you know there's an app called Calculator?
Yes.
And when you click on the app, it's a calculator. So the parents are thinking, oh, my kid has a calculator app. I feel so nice that he has one. If you click on it, you got to put the passcode, like 76542, in the calculator. Enter. It takes you into a behind-the-scenes platform now where you can share pictures and communicate with people. So it's a hidden calculator face into an open app. And they're trying to let parents know, look at these kinds of apps that your kids might be having that's what's happening.
Yeah.
When my son's playing video games, I'm like, who are you talking to? Like, I can hear some guy in Texas talking with them, and it sounds like a man. I feel very uncomfortable with that stuff because I'm like, what's going on here? And he can hear my son's 11-year-old sounding voice, right? So I think parents, when you're saying being aware of what their kids are into when it comes to the power of social media, is huge right now. Huge.
Yeah.
Okay, so that alone, okay. I mean, it blows my mind when you see like this, someone's 6-year-old has their own Instagram account.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. It's just like, boop, they're going to, you know.
And there's a lot of that.
What do you think when you hear 13-year-olds begging their parents to be on Instagram or any of the social media platforms, what's your thought?
So I'm not necessarily against, you know, social media use. I just think that as a parent, you have to monitor it. You know what I mean? So you should know, you know, children's passwords. You should be able to access to these accounts and see what's going on. But I think, you know, foundation is key. Do you know, like, we have to send our kids out into the world. I have a teenage daughter. You know what I mean? So we have to, as parents, equip them with the skills and the knowledge, because we can't always be there.
Yes.
Right? But if we build young people that are resilient, that have self-worth and self-love and self-respect, at least when we go out there, we know that, you know, we can hope that, like, they're not going to be able to be penetrated by this.
Yeah.
Because remember, predators, traffickers, they're looking for vulnerable children.
Yes.
They're not going to get every child. Right? Yeah. Why? Because they know that there's certain children that are specifically vulnerable. Yeah. And those are the ones that they're going after.
And not everyone's going to have physical vulnerabilities like being homeless.
Yeah. Okay. But the emotional, but the emotional self-esteem.
Psychological, as you're saying. Yeah. These inroads into it. I think when you, like, I mean, even that alone is gold. Talk to your kids about what consent means.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right.
I heard this 2 weeks ago, and it said one of the healthiest ways to foster, I guess, you know, a resiliency in your kids, I think that was kind of the word, was just to talk with them. Okay, so get this. Yeah. Newsflash.
Groundbreaking.
Groundbreaking.
Literally, but so
talking with your kids equips them to process the world and the ups and downs. Okay. And how many, I mean, all of us fall victim to it, where life is fast and it's quick, and we look for, you know, amusement through entertainment, and we sit alongside our own loved ones on a couch, but we don't look them in the eye or talk, or, you know, dinner is literally just quick, because we got to get, because soccer is starting in 30 minutes, quick, okay? But, you know, you don't know that your daughter could have been going through something that day, and she just wants to talk about it. You know, that is the trade-off. You know, I think in order for us to be even aware of what's going on with our kids, that we have to be looking or have our ear open to it.
And to be engaged.
And to that point, Mike, because my wife actually called me out on this the other day. I was home. I was on the phone. Then I left. Came back. I'm still on the phone. And I know my daughter wanted to say something to me. And she says, after, like, she goes, you know what? Just remember, if they can't talk with you because you're not available, they'll find somebody to talk to.
Yeah.
Ooh.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. That's a movie line.
Yeah. So to me, when she said that, I just threw the phone on the table. I'm like,
right away.
But it's very, very powerful. Like, just kind of what we're hearing today.
Yeah.
The simple thing of just being available to have that conversation.
Because what's the alternate?
Yeah.
You know, the alternate, you can't be everywhere. So I guess let's, are you going to buy a helicopter?
Right, exactly.
Let's be helicopter parents.
Yeah, exactly.
That's the alternate, right? Yeah, you're on top of them for everything.
Right.
Okay, that's amazing.
Yeah.
Just some of those, just the littlest things to help them have the eyes and the ears to process something.
Yeah.
You know, to feel like, okay, I did not trust that scenario. I got in that car. I didn't feel safe.
Yeah.
They wouldn't tell me where we're going. When I said that I didn't, was uncomfortable with it, they laughed at me. They ridiculed me. Okay, so are these really your friends? Things like, I mean, one of the greatest things I think anyone could have is just to think. Right? Just the ability to think and not just go with the flow, because, you know, even, I mean, that happens to anyone in any scenario, you know, they're void of their own thinking, or they're afraid that my thinking is in contrast to what everyone else is doing. Okay. That's not a juvenile thing. That's a people thing.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter how old, whether it's like people in Wall Street doing corruption at the highest level, mm-hmm. white collar crime. It's like, mm-hmm. well, everyone was kind of doing it at the senior executive level. Okay.
Yeah.
So let me ask you. So what are some other ways that human trafficking looks, you know, and
yeah.
just to get an idea.
Okay. So a couple things I would say for parents or anyone sort of who's interacting with young people is it's important to sort of know the signs. And this is why education and awareness is so important. So for young people, if you start to see changes, this is why, like you said, be engaged in your kid's life, because you start to see changes. If all of a sudden you see their grades dropping, if they start to dress differently, do you know what I mean? If they're constantly tired, if you start to see these little changes, you got to act on it immediately. Because I think a lot of times, you know, as parents, especially, you know, you said we're busy, we have teenagers, we're just like, okay, they're home, they're in bed, they're good, that's it.
Yeah.
You know, but no, like look for those little subtle changes within your teenager or the children in your life. And if you do see something, that's something to have that conversation with them. I think it's important for all young people to have that safe person that they can talk to. And that may not be mom and dad. It mm-hmm. could be your aunt. It could be just like a trusted adult in their yeah. life.
Coach.
It, yeah, whatever, coach, you know? A therapist. Mm-hmm. Like, if you don't want to talk to me, I get it, but can you talk to so-and-so? Mm-hmm. Just yeah. having that adult that they can speak with. And then another thing that I know is really helpful is having a safety plan with your children. You know, prior to before when they go out and they're kind of going on their own a lot, is to say, listen, if you ever get in a situation where you feel uncomfortable, where you don't feel safe, call me. Just say the word, like, you know, yep. whatever that is, yep. I'll be there and that's it. You don't have to say anything.
Yeah.
So, you know what I mean? Because, you know, sometimes kids, we do, you get in these situations and you don't want to call mom and dad because you don't want to get in trouble.
Yeah, exactly.
And so they just stay and God knows what happens. So it's right. like, just have that safety word, like banana.
That's
the dad banana. And you go, like, and you know.
Yes.
Yeah.
No questions asked.
No questions asked.
Yeah, nothing.
You yeah. Just,
that's amazing. That's a code word.
That's good.
Yeah,
that's
yeah.
Good.
I know. I've talked about that with my kids before. Yeah. And a code word because they could be in a situation where they
exactly
they don't feel at liberty to say come get me.
Yeah.
Right. You know where yeah. are you?
Or whatever. Yeah. Yeah,
yeah. Yeah. Okay. No, I mean, for myself, I made almost every single mistake in that fashion. I was in something. I was in over my head.
Mm.
I thought, mom and dad, and I said, you know what? I'm going to get in trouble if I say something. So I just stayed in,
yeah.
And then I actually got really good at even just swimming even deeper and deeper. Because mm-hmm. instead of going up, it's like, okay, I'm just gonna learn to hold my breath. And yeah. I started to get really good at navigating through there. And I went maybe easily 6 to 8 years without even telling my parents anything.
Yeah.
Okay. And it got me into a really bad situation. So, social media. I love just a little practical.
Yeah.
You know, along with the big things, it's like, what are the little things to look at in just an everyday life? Make your social media account private.
Yeah.
Okay. And if
only accept people that you know.
Okay. Right. Any other practices that you're aware of working with youth or that you know personally?
Yeah. Well, I think it's, again, you know, don't share private information.
Yeah.
You know, things like that. So you don't want to be sharing, you know, your innermost thoughts on social media. I know that's hard for young people because they like to, but things like that, like what are you sharing on social media? Just how we sort of be cognizant that whoever you're speaking to, whoever sees us, you don't know them.
Mm. Yeah. It's just out there.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Especially even the images. You don't own the images that you yes. put up. Anyone could take it, screenshot it, do whatever they want with it.
Exactly.
Yeah.
For sure. Is there the window of trafficking, mm-hmm. human trafficking, what would you say would be that age? So would you say, for example, between the ages of like maybe, I don't know, 13 and 19 is the window? Once you pass that, like in your 20s, it kind of doesn't happen as much?
No.
Okay.
No. So what I would say is typically it is sort of like that 13 to probably like 12 to maybe like 19, 20, 21 age range is where you see. But I've heard of a lot of college age, university age girls that are being lured into trafficking. So it's not just sort of like once they get out of high school, they're safe.
Right.
Because a lot of young women, even in their 20s, are lured into trafficking. It might look a little bit differently. It might now be, you know, meeting somebody on, you know, Tinder.
Okay. Yeah.
Again, you know what I mean? The guy presents himself as a boyfriend. He wants a relationship with you. And then once that trust is built, then comes the coercion, the manipulation. Another big thing right now is the whole sugar daddy, sugar baby. I don't know if you guys know yeah. about that. Yeah. But yeah, so a lot of young girls, particularly in the university age range, are looking for the sugar daddies. Right. And a lot of these sugar daddy websites like aggressively target university age, you know, young women. And so they get in these relationships with older men, typically, where they're exchanging money for sex.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, sometimes, you know, pay for school fees, pay for your lifestyle, but a lot that can potentially lead to trafficking. You know what I mean? You've already sort of stepped over that line where you're changing money for sex.
Right there.
And after that, like the power dynamic between the person that's paying and the young girl, obviously, and sometimes that can lead to the person saying, okay, well, now I want you to sleep with this person. Now I want you to do that. So there have been cases of a couple of women I've known who started off meeting a sugar daddy and then actually ended up being trafficked by their sugar daddy.
Really?
Yeah.
Can you elaborate on the term sugar daddy for those that don't have...
Yeah, so it's an older gentleman that will spoil a young woman.
Essentially,
yeah. Yeah, it's an exchange of usually, like, you know, a young woman spending time with, sleeping with an older gentleman for money and gifts.
Right.
Yeah.
And I think we've seen our fair share of those connections. I mean, we hear a lot of stories as well of those things. Yeah. Let me ask you this. So we obviously are giving the dynamic of what to do to empower our kids.
Yeah.
Now, what would you say are the traits that kids or people should look out for in that potential sex trafficker, right? So, so things like, if you have conversations that go like this, red flag, red flag, red flag, red flag.
Yeah, well, I would say, and this is like the point with the healthy relationships is so important. So if you meet somebody and they're just love bombing you, you know what I mean? You meet somebody and they're buying you gifts and they're spoiling you and you go from like 0 to 100 in 2 days. Yeah. Like they're saying, I love you, and you've known them for 3 days. That's a red flag.
Right.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So a lot of times young people, they just want that attention. Mm-hmm. But to understand that that's not healthy and it's not normal. So if you're meeting someone that's, you know, doing things that aren't appropriate, that's a red flag. There's something wrong and you need to step away from that.
Yeah. Okay. That's good. There's an alternate intention.
Yeah.
Yes.
For that attention. Okay.
And it could be anybody. That's the key there. It could be anybody.
Human trafficking, sex trafficking, what do you... You know, with the progress that you made, what needs to happen? Okay.
You
know, there's statements like, we need to end it. You know, you hear things like that. Is it possible? Is there ways to, you know, like, what are the steps? I know that you spoke, you're actually taking a political stand. You've had an opportunity to sit at a round table, right, with Justin Trudeau.
Yeah.
Which is incredible. Mm-hmm. So some of these, what are these other experiences that you've had? And, like, what do you see... Your effort, what is it? Is it creating a wave? What are you hoping to have happen?
Yeah, so I guess sort of my role as sort of an advocate within anti-human trafficking is, I think, first and foremost, to create awareness, because you can't fight a problem you don't know exists, right? And so most people don't know, like you said, that's what we started off here. Most people don't know human trafficking exists. They don't know what's happening here in Canada. And there's not a lot of attention paid to it. Do you know there's been a surge of gun violence in the last few weeks over the summer?
Yes.
With immediately news, media, stories, publicity, right? Because you can see gun violence. If there's a shooting in Liberty Village, we know it's happening.
Yes.
Whereas human trafficking, it's hidden. It's right there under the surface. So people just don't think it's existing, even though it's been happening for years and years and years. So I think just getting that just general awareness to the public that this is happening, people need to know about it. And then as far as with the advocacy piece, it's really trying to advocate for more services, right? I wouldn't really say services, I'd say more resources. So we have a lot of services available for survivors in Toronto. There's a lot of great organizations that are able to do a lot of great work. We have the Toronto Police. They have an amazing human trafficking enforcement team. Mm-hmm. But they need funding. It's like anything, you know what I mean? Like a lot of these grassroots nonprofits, I mean, they're working on shoestring budgets.
Well, and I think I've seen something else that when you were speaking, I think on CBC about there's so many cases. There's hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of cases that Toronto Police can't even keep up with it.
I think there was 1,000 cases within the last 5 years. I think over 300 victims that they've worked with. And that's what's been reported.
Yeah, we know.
And we know.
What's reported is just literally a fraction of...
That's like the tip of the iceberg to what's actually happening. So I think we just need more resources for survivors in the short term and also the long term. So what I found too is I had a lot of people reach out to me and say, you know, my daughter or my niece is a survivor, but her trafficking happened 10 years ago. There's no services for her today. She's still struggling with addiction, with mental health, with trauma, you know?
Yes.
And there's nothing available for her because she's not immediately out of a trafficking situation. So you know, trauma impacts you for the rest of your life. Yes. It doesn't just go away in 1 year.
It shapes you in a way.
It shapes you. So we need services for, yes, you know, after, you know, a survivor has been rescued, but also like throughout the lifetime, they're going to need care and services.
Okay.
Yeah, because it's not just about falling or being plucked out. It's like, what happens next?
What happens next? You know, there's so many things. Just, you know, again, because a lot of young women don't have an education, job opportunities, children, so you need like childcare and support. Yeah. A lot of women who have been trafficked also have charges related to their trafficking because they had to hold drugs or guns. So now this impedes their success in life. So there's so many things that they need to sort of be able to reclaim their lives.
That speaks to like abuse as a whole. I mean, if the resources aren't there, those who have been abused are they can be susceptible to abuse as well, whether it's emotional, sexual, or physical. You know, that's one of those things where you hear about someone saying like, I don't want to do it, but you know, it was done to me.
Yeah.
Right. You know, this so-and-so, this family member, this person beat me, and they end up doing the same thing to their loved ones, you know, and resources and resource. When you, that word, it's a holistic word. Like, you know, it seems very generalized. Yeah. What does resources in,
so
what does that
specifically
look like?
Funding. Funding, right, money. Okay, so that's the thing. You need money to be able to keep these programs operating. And you need money to be able to increase them. So that's the thing, too. So just even to address the scale of the problem, there's just not enough, you know, there's not enough safe homes for survivors.
Yes.
Right? So after they come out of a trafficking situation, they need a place to stay where they can get that round-the-clock care. There's not enough of that in Toronto. We do have some, which is amazing, but we need more. Mm-hmm. So it's things like that where you just need more funding dollars to go into this.
So that's great. So that just gives an idea of like how to connect. Safe houses is one. What else is there? What else does resources cover?
So safe houses, any sort of, you know, care, like I was saying. So education supports is a big one. Economic opportunities. So, you know, employment opportunities for them to be able to get jobs and support themselves. Childcare is huge. Because a lot of women have children. Mm-hmm. Their legal supports. You need legal supports. You know, sometimes if you have a child with the trafficker, which happens a lot.
Wow.
Right? So how do you manage that? Mm. Or you have charges, again, because, you know, things you were forced to do when you were being trafficked. Yeah. You have to have, you know, deal with that. So there's a lot of different things that women are dealing with, these young women, to try to get their lives back together. So I think that's really where we need a lot of the funding. And again, short term and long term.
Yeah. I know that RISE is a social enterprise.
Yeah.
It's not a nonprofit.
Yeah.
Okay. So given, like, if someone was saying like, hey, I'm really hearing what this is. I want to give thousands of dollars towards it. I used to work in nonprofit for 10 years. We worked with, you know, marginalized youth in marginalized neighborhoods that were at risk. And there's always like a new name, you know. I know exactly how millions of dollars translated into programs, set people up, the right people with the right heart to effect change and go into neighborhoods and really, I literally revolutionized what was happening in that neighborhood and changed the stigma there. And like, so I've seen that it can help. What would, if someone wants to give to RISE, what's some of the things that you're doing?
Yeah. So one of the things is working sort of directly with young people. So through the workshops. So it's a series of workshops that I facilitate. Yeah.
Amazing.
So focus on things again, like health and wellness, building resiliency. Because I think for me, one of the things that really, I think, helped me sort of be able to come from these experiences was the fact that I was able to really tap into that. So things like mindfulness. Mindfulness is amazing. Hmm. You know what I mean? So it's a practice that I do daily. And it's one of those, I think, coping kind of like strategies that really important for young people to have. So when you feel, you know, anxiety, when you feel depressed, when you have these, to be able to just take that moment to just breathe and really become centered and be in the moment, right? Because a lot of times when you dealt with trauma is you're in the past. You're always replaying those horrible thoughts and those horrible memories. And that can be re-traumatizing again and again.
Damaging over
right?
and over.
Yeah. Yes. So mindfulness helps you kind of stay centered. So that's kind of like with RISE what I like to do, but also education and awareness. So going and speaking to whether it's, you know, young people, teachers, people like that who interact with young people, just to sort of give them sort of what are the warning signs of human trafficking, what are the things to look out for. And of course, I always like talking to young people and just sharing my story, because I feel that that really helps them to be able to see somebody that's been through it and to say, oh, okay. But also kind of to explain to them what happened before. So what was it that led me to a position that I was so vulnerable, right?
Yes, right.
Because I was, I have a family. I have a great family. I love my family. And I had these vulnerabilities, but I didn't tell anybody. I didn't, you know what I mean? I didn't know how to articulate what I was feeling. So I just kept it in. And had I been able to say to somebody, listen, like, I'm hurting. I need help. Because I have someone to talk to. I never would have left home. Mm-hmm. Right?
Yes.
So this is like, when I talk to young people, it's saying, wow. You know, if you're going through something, find someone to talk to.
Find someone.
Don't leave home. Don't do these drastic things because you're only going to put yourself in more danger.
Yeah. That's good. Let me ask you this. What are your upcoming projects right now that you're working on and events around the whole Rising issue?
Okay. So I guess, so September 21st, I'll be at the Freedom event. So it's the Freedom Walk. It's the 7th annual walk. So if anyone's to come out to support, I'll be walking also with the keynote speaker.
Okay.
And with the Rise, just continually going to be speaking and working with young people. So
okay.
I guess if anyone's interested, they can check out my website and you'll be sharing all that stuff.
Why don't you say that right now? We'll put it on the links as well.
Okay. Yeah. So my website is just www.rhonellebruder.com.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And then my social media handles is Real Rhonelle.
Okay.
Oh, I like that.
Yeah.
Rhonelle spelled R-H-O-N-E-L-L-E.
Yes.
B-R-U-D-E-R.
Yes. Okay. Bruder. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
That's amazing. We'll definitely do that. Rhonelle, I want to really thank you for coming down here. I mean, what you've shared today, obviously, to me, takes a lot of courage. Mm-hmm. I mean, and it's also a message that I think someone will be listening to or someone can listen to. And if they're stuck right now, if they're in a situation or if they know someone that's in a situation, that they can basically provide that insight and just provide that support.
I want to ask you on that. Yeah. Have you had a chance to go into any high schools?
So not yet. So I'm actually working on that.
Yeah.
To be out, because that's definitely something I'd want to do, is like to go into high school.
A workshop means that, you know, they come to you.
Yeah.
Yes. Right. You know, I'm just curious if you were able to go. I mean, thinking from the high school's perspective, have they been receptive to it at all? Do you know? Have you had?
So I haven't sort of engaged yet.
Yeah.
So most of the stuff I did with Rise has been with organizations that already have sort of, you know, a place, and then I would just go in and sort of facilitate the workshops.
Yes.
But definitely. So speaking to young people is sort of the direction, because to me, I feel like it's that prevention work. Mm-hmm. And that's really where the gap is. So I really want to be able to really talk with young people, high school, but also elementary.
Mm. Yes.
Because by the time someone's in high school,
it might be too late.
Yeah. You're right.
So,
and that's, I think, good, see, this is you know, the thing of labels. I mean, I've for myself, I love to escape them.
Yes.
Okay. You know, someone throws it on you. I know who you are based on how you look, how you talk, or whatever. So look, your life is so much more than being someone who's come through sex trafficking.
Yes.
Okay. So, you know, I would say this, if you were to approach a high school, you know, when you talk about Rise, that is a universal theme, that element of that. You have obviously personal experience that you can pull from, and you can let people know when they say, oh, you don't understand, miss, you know, you don't understand what we're going through. To me, the appeal to high school is, you know, if the administrators, like the faculty, the principals of each school, if they had an idea of your background and you said, look, let me speak to the girls in your school, okay, and start from there and possibly open it up. We have a really good friend. He goes all over the world and speaks, and he spoke on bullying.
Mm.
And one thing that he did is he actually, during National Bullying Awareness Week, this is how he started. He contacted all these school boards and said, for this week, which is a week in November, I will take assemblies for free. And he said, you know, for the next day, you have 24 hours to book me. Within like 4 hours or something like that, something crazy, he was booked the whole week, Monday to Friday, just nonstop.
Yeah.
Before that, for a year, he got into two schools. He was trying and trying.
Yeah.
Okay. And I say that, but his message was, he himself was a barrier to his message getting out. Mm-hmm. And when he just opened it up and said, look, you need to hear this. He has never marketed. He's never spent a dollar on doing anything to try to elicit or solicit him being booked for a school. From that 1 week, he said, and that was 10 years ago, that everything has literally grown from that 1 week. There was someone in a school board who was in charge of 14 schools who almost grabbed him after and said, I have to get you in every school. And immediately that afternoon made phone calls and booked him in 14 other schools. Okay. And it just started and started. Now he's speaking on mental health, you know, not mental illness, about mental health, about, you know, and that it involves mental illness, but also that there's a mental health that we don't ignore, because, and he said those exact words, you don't see it. Yeah. So no one really knows what's really going on with that kid in your class, okay? And he's really great at that. He uses everything from music and his personality, but he actually shares some really difficult things with kids, personal stories as well as things in the news. You definitely embody that. You have that.
Yeah. Oh, thank you.
Yeah, you have that, you have that relatability. You can speak kind of in any circle. So I just want to encourage you that don't, be bold. Go in there.
Yeah.
And maybe, and think about from the school's perspective, they may not be really open to having your full story shared.
Yes, I know.
Right? And I know you're obviously aware of that. But there's something that you could speak to that is definitely an issue. Things like consent. Let me talk to your girls about what consent means.
Right.
That is massive. That is massive. Okay, like that word alone and what that, the power of understanding, you know, what that really should look like to a girl aged, you know, 10 to 20, that could change their life. That 100% can change your life. And that, and that's where, you know, for the, our friend, his name's Anthony, his word was bullying. That was the buzzword that, okay, I think if you were to find a word that kind of encapsulated or at least was a beginning step for you that you could break, you know, kids need to hear what you've gone through, your perspective on life. And it's not just those years of, or that year when you were 16. It's, there's so much more beyond that.
Yeah.
So I just want to encourage you to do that. Yeah.
No, that's really good advice, because I think that just sort of the language in itself, like human trafficking, is taboo.
Yes.
So that's sometimes where you hit sort of a lot of the barriers, because people are like, we don't want to talk about this. So maybe you're right, reframing it about consent, about boundaries, relationships. That might be
better.
And if you need some resources and connections, please reach out. I mean, we're 100% like willing to, you know, help with this cause.
We'll keep in touch with everything that you're doing. If there's anything that we can do, we're always, if we can do something, we will.
Exactly.
To help, open the door.
Amazing. Okay. Thanks. Amazing. Well, Rhonelle, thank you so much.
All right. Thank you.
And looking forward to what the world has to bring. Amazing. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Have a great one. Coming. Take care.
Listen to this episode on iTunes and Spotify. Make sure to drop by next week. And don't forget to subscribe.
Let's go.
It's time to give a shout out to our sponsors. This podcast is brought to you by Sentinel Security Plus. For all your premium security needs, visit SentinelSecurityPlus.com. And The Substance Group. For all your integrated marketing solutions, visit TheSubstanceGroup.com.